The ESP32 family of microcontrollers are capable devices with many built-in peripherals, including Bluetooth and Wi-Fi. The official SDK and toolchain is the ESP IoT Development Framework, or ESP-IDF for short. It uses FreeRTOS as its real-time operating system. However, in this tutorial series, we'll use the Zephyr real-time operating system and SDK to program the firmware for the ESP32. To follow along, install Zephyr for your operating system according to the setup instructions on the Zephyr project website. The link is provided in the video description. As a friendly warning, don't try to build the Zephyr Blinky example. Instead, build the Hello World sample by following the ESP32 specific instructions that are also linked in the video description. In fact, this tutorial series builds up to being able to compile, run, and most importantly, understand the Zephyr Blinky example by explaining concepts such as device trees, aliases, and node labels. But we're getting slightly ahead of ourselves, so let's start by putting together a simple LED blinking circuit on the breadboard. I'm using the ESP32 W Rover-E module for this tutorial, but you can use pretty much any ESP32 module or development board that you have lying around. Connect pin 25 on the ESP32 module to an LED, and a resistor in series, and we're done with the physical setup. To keep the firmware organized, make a directory called Hello World to contain our LED blinking application. Within that directory, create a subdirectory called source for our single C source file main.c. Zephyr uses CMake as its meta build system. So next, let's create a file called cmakelists.txt. Note the plural in lists, and type the following contents. Don't focus on the details of the CMake commands. Consider it boilerplate code for now. Let's write a bare bones main.c file to make sure that it compiles. The kmsleep function just makes the application sleep for 1000 milliseconds or 1 second. Build the application by running the west meta tool in the Hello World directory. You'll get a build error if you try to run it from the source directory. If the build is successful, try to flash the ESP32 board. If the board was flashed successfully, try to monitor the serial console. Of course, you'll not see much, since our application simply runs an infinite loop with 1 second of sleep each time. However, you should see a line like the following in the output. Congratulations! We're now running Zephyr OS on the ESP32. To blink an LED, we configure one of the GPIO pins on the ESP32 board to alternate between high and low output. To configure GPIOs, we first need to understand a key concept in Zephyr, namely that of a device. Simply speaking, if you can get a hold of a pointer to a device struct, you can call a lot of Zephyr APIs by passing that pointer as an argument. For example, the ESP32 board has two GPIO controller devices. They're called GPIO 0 and GPIO 1. How do I know that, you might ask? Well, they're defined for the ESP32 board in a device tree, which is what Zephyr uses to hierarchically describe the capabilities of a board. Specifically, the file ESP32.dtsi contains the following device tree. Note that I've cut out several lines that are not relevant to us right now. The device tree shows a hierarchy, with a forward slash being the root node, and then there are subnodes and subnodes of subnodes and so on. For our GPIOs, we can see that there are two GPIO controllers defined. GPIO at 3FF4400 and GPIO at 3FF44800. They're both subnodes of GPIO, which itself is a subnode of SOC, which is a subnode of slash. So the full path to the first GPIO controller is /SOC/GPIO/GPIO@3FF44000. As you might have guessed, the 3FF44000 part refers to the ESP32 memory address. In device tree parlance, these are called unit addresses. We can confirm it by checking the ESP technical reference manual in Table 6, where indeed the address range hex 3FF44000 to hex 3FF44FF is mapped to GPIO. To summarize, this device tree defines two GPIO controllers, one starting at address hex 3FF44000 and the other at address hex 3FF44800. Both have a size of hex 800, as specified in the second element under the reg or reg property. However, it's a bit inconvenient to refer to the memory addresses all the time in our code, so this device tree has defined two node labels for the controllers, GPIO0 and GPIO1. Node labels are the strings before the colon. For example, GPIO0:GPIO@3FF44000. We'll use the node labels to get a device pointer to the GPIO controller. Also note that the first controller, GPIO0, controls the first 32 GPIO pins, namely pins 0 to 31. And the second controller, GPIO1, controls the pins from 32 to 39. So if you'd like to use GPIO pin 31 to blink an LED, you should reference GPIO0. If you'd like to use GPIO pin 32, you should reference GPIO1. Armed with this information, let's try to get a device pointer to one of these controllers. In the main.c source file, include the device.h header that defines key macros that we'll use. We define a pointer to the struct device called GPIOCTDEV for GPIO controller device. Of course, you can call it something else if you prefer. The macro device DTGET expands to the device pointer we're looking for, but it needs a node identifier from the device tree to provide that device pointer. Thankfully, the DT node label macro is expanded to a node identifier when provided with the node label. In this case, we'd like to use the first controller, so we provide the node label GPIO0. To be honest, I'm still trying to wrap my head around all the complexities of the macro expansions in Zephyr. However, their magic helps to ensure that only relevant devices are included in the application build, and there's no overhead since all the device tree traversing is done by the preprocessor and converted into a header file with all the device identifiers as pound defines. I've linked to a very good presentation of the macro expansion magic in the video description. It's time to configure the GPIO controller pins. In the main function, we first check if the GPIO controller, GPIO0, is ready to be used. There's a handy function, deviceIsReady, that takes a device pointer and returns a bool. Next, let's configure GPIO pin 25 to be an output pin. The GPIO pin configure function takes a device pointer, a pin number, and flags as arguments. This function is declared in the gpio.h header file, so be sure to include it. Finally, let's blink the LED. To keep things simple and start with the basics, we'll use the GPIO pin set raw function. It takes, you guessed it, a pointer to a device struct, the pin number, and whether to set the pin high or low, using 1 or 0 respectively. The raw part of the function indicates that it sets the pin voltage level directly. This paradigm is probably familiar to you if you've programmed other microcontrollers in the past. In future videos, we'll use some other functions that abstract away from the raw pin setting and includes consideration for whether a pin is active high or active low, for example. Build and flash the board, and behold the beautiful sight of a blinking LED. You can find a code for this example on my GitHub repository linked in the video description. In the next video, we'll try to understand some new concepts like DT alias and device tree overlays, and modify our code to look more like the Zephyr project's blinky sample code.